have a lesson called Four Raindrops. And what this lesson is, it is modeling urban hydrology versus forested hydrology. So you guys are stormwater professionals, you probably know all about how that land cover change affects how water moves. That's what this is all about. It's really about water quantity. However, some tweaks that I do to the lesson also bring in a little bit of water quality. So this is Susie's lesson. And you know, with any lesson out there, when you're an educator, you always make your own tweaks to it. So this is Susie's lesson with like a little bit of my delays on top of it. But I'm gonna let Susie go ahead and lead this, because last time I led this for a training, it's been like 3 years and I'm really, really rusty. So I'm gonna kind of chime in and be like, or you could do it this way. But Susie's really going to lead this lesson. And we'll start off with, this is an example of modeling. So when it comes to teaching K-12 students, you really want to sell these lessons to the teachers for what they need, and they may not really give a crap about stormwater, they might, but they're really going to care about the science standards and teaching kids to think like a scientist. Modeling is a big part of the next gen science standards. It's one of the cross-cutting concepts. So scientists have a saying, all models are wrong, but some models are useful. Today we're going to turn you into raindrops. And through you and your raindrop selves, we are going to model how rain or stormwater moves differently in an urban versus a forested landscape. Do keep in mind, this is a lesson that you really need to do with a minimum of like 20 when you're doing it with students, or it's just not really the best way to go about this. But I think for what we're doing today, we're going to be stepping back and forth between treating you like kids and treating you like teachers. So we will be going back and forth that way. So you can learn how to teach the lesson as well as, you know, be in it as well. Any other intro you'd like from me?
No, we'll just jump into it.
Oh, and this is a part of Drain Rangers. So that's coming out very soon. The website is so close. It's not gonna happen by my last day tomorrow, but it will be happening by June. We just extended the contract, FYI, and then June to wrap up.
And Dave's going to do?
Dave's taking all my
after. Okay.
So, all 27 of them.
So for teachers, you know, all this material will be in up online in the PEI website for a while. And it's formatted for teachers. So, you know, there's the objective, what, you know, why would they do this? But really, again, all the drain ranger materials are formatted like the tests that the students have to take. So the idea here is that, say, their theme might be
bird bills or something like, you know, shape of bird bills.
So maybe that's the lesson they do in their testing. But they need to see the format several different times with different themes. So that's what we're taking advantage of, is that the stormwater is a theme they can use to see the pattern of how the lessons flow and the materials that they get. So this is just one part of it. But anyway, so I'm really excited about drain rangers from our perspective, and I think teachers will be really excited about it from their perspective and prepping students for tests. So to do four raindrops, you need to kind of think ahead just a little bit about, you've got all these students, and like Cara said, usually one class is going to be close to 28 kids. And how they're going to be moving around in the classroom. And lots of classrooms don't have this big open space, so you're going to move guests around, things like that. So let's just jump into it. So each of you is going to be a raindrop. Just take a raindrop. And then hold your raindrop so that the world can see the green side. So there should be a yellow side and a blue side.
Yeah.
I know, they're pretty, the green is kind of yellow.
Close.
That's
okay.
Extras. I might stop off some of you. Oh my goodness.
They're really acting like a crayon, aren't they?
Okay, so we're going to run through our model twice, and we're going to get different results. We're going to record our information, and then we're going to do some graphing with it. So, raindrops. come, oh, let me, oh, one other thing. So we're all going to be out over Puget Sound, and then we're going to blow in on the cloud, and we're going to rain down on a watershed. So I'm going to construct our watershed. So down here at the bottom of the hill is a creek. So normally I would have students be doing this, but we don't have enough people to spare today. And up here is the top of the hill where there's forest, and there's actually forest throughout the whole watershed. And we have a forest and wetland kind of here in the middle. And this is about, this first scenario is about 10 years ago. So, and I usually use 10 years because usually we're doing this with fourth and fifth graders. That's a time span. Even if they don't remember 10 years ago, they get what 10 years ago was. So, okay, so raindrops. Come meet me over the cloud over here. Come on.
Come on, raindrop.
Okay, stay in the cloud over there. So let's huddle up. We're a cloud. We're not a long cloud. We're a munchy cloud.
Yeah.
So again, it's 10 years ago, and we're in a cloud. We're over Puget Sound, and it's kind of like November. So it's kind of cold, blustery, and the wind is going to blow us as a cloud over to the top of this hill over here. So. Okay, so we're kind of hovering over this, and we're going to fall out of the sky down to the forest, okay? So everyone, when there's a big, dense forest, something that's going to look like this, so we raindrops, are we going to fall all the way down to the ground, right off the spot, right off the bat? What's going to happen to us? So everyone kind of simulate that to model that we're in trees, just kind of bend over like this. So we haven't got to the ground yet. So even though it's November, it's kind of windy, and so the wind is going to cause some of the raindrops to kind of go up back up the clouds. So does anybody know what that process is called? So everyone who has an evaporation rain cloud or raindrop, you can stand up and go back over to where the cloud is. So these guys are done with their water cycle. They don't even touch the ground. They're done with their water cycle. Okay, so another thing that happens, the rest of us actually drip down through the branches and we finally get to the ground. How long do you think that's going to take? I mean, in real life, how long?
These days.
Tall trees. A minute?
Maybe
longer than a minute.
10 minutes.
I'd say like maybe several hours. Okay, so let's fast forward several hours. We've all dropped down to the grass. Now we're actually on the ground. So the next thing that's going to happen is some of us are going to get sucked up by the roots of some of the trees because they're kind of thirsty. And then we raindrops that get sucked up by the trees, we're going to go up through the trees. Eventually, we're going to be, in a sense, sweated out of the pores of the trees. And that process is called
tree spreading.
Yeah. So, you guys, you're talking about the water cycle, too. So, you can stand up, and now you're water vapor, and you're going back up to the clouds. Well, so, there's a few raindrops left. So, let's see what's called infiltration. Does anybody know what that process is?
Absorbing it.
Okay, so we've got two infiltration raindrops. You guys are going to come over here to the side, and you're going to sit. Because you're not going to go up into the cloud yet, right?
Correct.
They're still in their water, their first water cycle. So now, what infiltration raindrops do is they very slowly, because they're in the ground, they're underground. They're very slowly seeping downhill. So for every minute of real time, you guys can move an inch down toward the creek. An inch? So how long do you think it's going to take them to get to the creek in real life?
Years.
It could be years. It's certainly months. Yeah, certainly months, because they're in the ground.
I think you guys can do some math.
Okay, so for every minute that I'm talking, you guys can move a whole inch.
Do we estimate the
Okay, so now we've got two people. So this is one of the pieces of data that we need to collect. So everyone help us remember, we've got two raindrops that are going to actually turn into surface water. That means they can flow over the surface down to the creek. Okay? So we need a timer.
Sure.
So surface raindrops, stand up. And I guess I'm not part of it.
Can you guys see the clock? It's right there.
Great. Can you do the, oh, right there.
Duh.
Okay.
There's no second hand on that.
So again, this is 10 years ago. This is all forest. As far as we can see between here and the creek is forest trees. And so raindrops, even if you're on the surface, you have to kind of go slowly because there's what's going to kind of impede their path.
Rocks,
vegetation, duff, floors. So lots of different things. So when you guys are moving, your goal is to get to the creek. We're going to time it to see how long it takes. But you can, can only take like little steps like this. Heel to toe. And there's this thing here in the middle of our trip called a forest and wetland. So I'll be a forest and wetland. And if the forest and wetland reaches out and touches you, you have to stop in place and count to 10.
Okay.
Before you can continue your journey.
All right.
Okay, so timer, are we ready?
Sure.
Okay, on your marks, get set, seep.
One, two, three, four.
Hit infiltration, six to
ground. Yeah, you guys move it? I'm okay, attention.
I know, I'm with my
hand. 10.
You're stopped and hanging out in the wetland.
20.
Remember, this is how long it takes to get there. Okay,
37 seconds.
37 seconds. Okay, so we have two raindrops that went from there to there in 37 seconds. Okay, so that's 10 years ago. Okay, so you guys, So we're gonna shortcut your trip. You guys aren't gonna get to finish your water cycle. So now let's fast forward to 10 years into the future from when we did this, which is today. So let's everybody gets to be a raindrop again. And turn it over so that your yellow side is shown to the world. So let's turn over our watershed parts too. So up here at the top of the hill, we've had a few houses built. And they're all done, you know, according to all the permits and everything. Over here, our forest and wetland. So now, the wetland soils are still here. There's houses that are nearby. But, you know, the wetland, even though it's still there, it's not quite working the way it used to. So this time, it's not going to be able to reach out and tag people, get boundaries. The creek, it's still there. Okay. So we're fast forwarded. It's 10 years into the future from the last time we played, which is today. So we're in a cloud again. So huddle around. Have your yellow sides out. All your raindrops. Oh, I'm already noticing. Okay, so the wind is, it's a dark November night, and the wind is blowing, and we just have to go over to the same watershed. So. So we're up in the clouds still. I wanted to do one other thing with our watershed. Because of all these houses and people that live here now, instead of just trees, so people make, you know, just in our everyday life, people have dogs, and so sometimes they don't pick up after the dog, so sometimes dog waste gets left a lot. Sometimes there's a little bit of oil from a drip here, too. That's not a horrible leak, but you know, one drip, another drip of oil. People like to have green lawns, so some people fertilize, and they put a little bit too much on. So some excess chemical fertilizers. People had bugs in their lawn. They wanted to kill the bugs. They put out some herbicides, actually pesticides, and some pesticides. More pesticides. And so, herbicides. So the herbicides would actually be for like weed killers. So somebody had lots of weeds and more dogs. So we've got all this different kind of pollution kind of hanging out in different places in the watershed. So we're in the cloud still, and we rain down on this area. But guess what? Where there used to be trees, there's, you see any trees here? No tree. So this time, when we fall out of the cloud, we're going to go straight to the ground. Okay, so everyone rain down to this neighborhood. So what was the first thing that happened last time in our story? A little bit of evaporation. So I'm looking around, and I see one droplet of evaporation. Because, you know, that's still going to happen, right? The wind comes out, sun comes out, a little bit of the stormwater is going to evaporate. So you can get up if you're evaporation and go back over to the cloud. And what was the next thing that happened?
Transpiration.
Tree sweat.
Yeah, tree sweat. So we don't have big trees, but lawns, grass, bushes, you know, things like that, they will still do the same process of transpiration. Just not, I mean, a little bush that's 4 feet tall is not going to transpire as much as a tree that's 200 feet tall. But we have a little bit of transpiration. So you got sucked up into a blade of grass, and then you got transpired out through the pores of the grass, and you're back to the cloud. You're done. Now, what was the next one?
Infiltration.
Okay, so we still have places where water can infiltrate into the ground. So you guys know what to do. Head over here, sit down, and you're soaked into the groundwater or into the soil. So everybody else is going to be surface water runoff. We've got more droplets this time. So 1, 2, 3, 4, we've got 6 water droplets. And guess what? We're going to time you again. Okay? So everyone stand up if you're surface water. And you guys, every minute, because you are on the same ground, so every minute you can move downstream. Okay? So now, this time you guys can walk like as fast as you can normally in the halls. So you can't run, right? But when you pass a piece of pollution, you have to bend over again. Okay? So we're gonna time. Who's ready? Who's gonna time us?
Okay. On it.
You ready?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Water droplets. Again, you can walk at a normal pace and no penalties because the wetland's not gonna, well, I'll stand here, but my hands are tied. Okay, so I marks, get set, run off.
0. 1.
Pick up the pollution that
2.
You pass in.
3. 4. 5.
Time.
6. Seconds.
6 seconds, and we have 6 water droplets. Okay, excellent. So let's go back to our desk, and we're going to put all this data that we just collected into a worksheet, and we're going to do a little bit more thinking about this.
Great. When you guys go ahead and sit down, this is a good time for me to jump in and let you know how I do things slightly different than Susie.
I mean, you guys do a fair amount of teaching. There's no real wrong way to do these things. It really depends on the age. Susie gave you a great example of how to do this in elementary. I've done this with retired beach watchers. I've done this with community college students. And so it really depends on who your students are, what you're trying to get across, and these pictures are in your diagram is the differences. They're in your packets, I mean. Between the way the water moves and the water budget, basically, how it's different. So, but a couple of tips. I sometimes, especially for younger kids, I'll do one of two things. I will go over evaporation, transpiration, and filtration before we get in the huddle, because when you're younger and you're just moving around so much and you're not paying attention at all. So you might want to go over that a little bit before you get them in the cloud.
Yeah. Probably if they're younger than fourth and fifth graders, I can, especially older fourth graders at the end of the school year, you can get away with doing the conversation in the cloud. Mm-hmm. Younger than that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Another thing that I do is sometimes we'll go through what Susie did, each step, evaporation, transpiration, et cetera, but then we'll be like, okay, that was a practice run, now we're all going to do it together. And so repeating that, you know, one, reinforces the lesson, but two, helps with the timing. You know, everyone know where they're going, okay, go, and then everyone's doing something during the time portion. Because you all are really raining at once, and want a model to be more useful than wrong. So that's one thing that you can do. And I guess back to the doing this with older students, I mean, feel free to step back and take some time to really discuss some of the mechanisms, you know, there, about how for how,
exactly why evaporation changes, you know, exactly why transpiration changes. With the younger students, you're going to lose their attention. But with the older ones, you can really kind of get into the nitty-gritty of, you know, how the water is falling on the surfaces of the trees, which act like umbrellas, and they're much more exposed to wind and sun, et cetera, et cetera. So, because that is kind of the point, is not just how, but why the water budget changes.
The other thing that'll happen when you're doing this with a normal class these days is, you know, approaching 30 students. So if you take three out to be the watershed parts, you've still got a pretty good group of people. And the first time, it's always going to be just a few people. So when you have these water droplets kind of going into the creek, it's really truly no big deal, like it used to be in all of our watersheds. And then when you do it the second time, you've got basically the whole classroom descending on them pretty fast, at a walking fast walking pace. I would usually ask the creek, so how did it feel the first time versus the second time? And lots of times also you'll have this group of people that would just be ponded upstream from the creek. They can't get into the creek to cross that finish line. So it's, I don't think I've ever had to say it, but people, the kids will say, it's flooding. So I mean, that part of this model works really nicely.
Yeah, it's first and foremost a quantity lesson. I just threw those chips in there. Just because, oh, I'll do it definitely sometimes too. So depending on where you are at with the students, I mean, if you are doing the full-blown drain raiders, you've already read the awesome article that Ustormos put together. And so it's a good review. You may not even need to explain, even how to predict the event, you know. Well, all this is on a lawn. What do you think that could be? And then they find out what they are. Those are just different ways, and I'm sure you guys will figure out additional ways to tweak this lesson. Sue, so let's just math.
Okay.
Back on camera.
So how are we going to actually do this?
I don't know. We don't have a whiteboard, do we? Well, they have their worksheets. Though.
Yeah.
So turn to whatever page has a graph. And I might be able to, if I'm fast enough, I might be able to get it going up on here.
There's a graph on page 4.
You know, I should be able to get it up on here.
So the first few pages are all basically kind of the lesson plan and background for the teachers. And, you know, if it's any of us, STORM members are actually going to go out and do this with students. You know, more the how to set up the game, things to think about, that will be new to you, but not the stormwater part. So go back. There's a worksheet someplace in here.
Must be the last couple pages.
No.
Can't hear it.
So, yeah, 16. So number one is just so that we're all talking, you know, some of the same vocabulary. So just reviewing, because again, in the Drain Rangers program, they've already had some pre-readings. So just to remind people that, you know, the watershed. So have you probably all had discussions with people where you're using the term watershed, and the people you're talking with have a totally different interpretation of what a watershed is.
Correct.
So the one I get quite often is when the people are talking to me, they'll be using the word, but when you listen to them, they're talking about the river itself, the ribbon of water, and not the land surrounding it. That's probably the biggest misconception that I hear, or people who've lived in, say, an urban area where their drinking water watershed is some little spot up in the hills that, you know, they've heard about, but they've never been there. That's the watershed. The rest of the stuff, they don't have a name for it. So, again, I like to, when I'm working with adults or students, just kind of remind people, because the drinking water watershed is not a wrong definition, it's just not the one that we're using when we're talking about landforms. So just going over that definition to make sure people know that we're talking about from the tops of the ridge, all the land down to the bottom of the valley. So number two is where we put in, or the students would put in, the numbers that they actually collected from their real model. So total number of raindrops was 10, looks like, for our example. So that's what the students would write down, 10, number of students minus the creeks. The second bit of data is total number of raindrops that actually reached the creek. And this is in the forested, so number two is in the forested setting. So that was?
Two.
And length of time in seconds?
37.
Okay. And then we would go down and do
the data for the what we gathered in the suburban area. So total number of raindrops should be the same, right? And this is, again, for us, it's like, duh. But for students, actually what I do when I have time is I have them do the first round, and then I have them, I actually have another little bit in here. I have them do predictions. And some kids, because they now see kind of what the gist of it is, I tell them how we're going to change it and have them do a prediction. And some kids, you know, just their intuitive sense, they know what the answers are kind of going to be. They know more raindrops, and they get faster time. They may not get the right number of seconds. But as some kids are just like, I'm just going to guess. So anyway, three, so we would put in total number of raindrops was 10. In our second urbanized setting, total number of raindrops actually reached the creek was 6, I believe.
Yep.
And how long did it take us? 6 seconds?
Yes.
It was,
six.
The point is it's going to be way faster. So then, on 4, again, just a little bit of, you know, bringing some English and language arts in here, just having kids think about some of the, you know, the Latin. Hydro is water, and then graph, so we're going to be drawing a hydrograph, but that really means it's a picture of how the water flowed. So then B has the students just graph these two different scenarios that we did. So the instructions are to find the point on the graph where the number of raindrops that reached the creek, which was in the first time it was 2, intersects with the number of seconds. So you would do you go up 2 for number of drops and out to 37-ish, and you put a circle, and then the instructions tell you to draw kind of a line from 0 up to the circle. And then
here, guys, you can see on here. It's like 2 and 37 are darn close enough. There, there.
And then does this actually have you draw the other half of it? Draw a line back down to the graph, so that's the third part. So draw a solid line that curves from 0 to that dot, and then back down to the line again, down to 0. And then do the same. So usually in a classroom, I'll do that with the kids as an example on the board, so they can see. And then I'll have the students do C all on their own, and I'll just walk around and check. So what they'll have is they will have a flood, a peak flow that's pretty low, that you know we're used to seeing in our old graphs. And then the second one would be, think about where that would go. So you would have 10 drops that took 6 seconds, so it would be a much sharper peak, which is what we're all used to seeing in our cities.
That puts an example.
Yeah. And then number 5 just has them. How does the graph communicate the difference in graph between the forested scenario and the first one in? So that's a chance for the kids. I would have them work in small groups of 2 or 3 and just kind of talk about this. And I also, so they've taken out my favorite part of this lesson, is we'll have the students actually figure out. So this is, the green line is how it used to be, and I'll take the time to tell students how the yellow line is actually the reason that my group is in business, and it causes, you know, this type of how the water flow has changed, employs a lot of people. And the engineers have, you know, realized that this phenomenon happens. So I tell the kids, I have them think about, so how would you get that yellow line to be back closer to the green line? You know, what are some of the things that you would do in your neighborhood?
It's in there, but is there a worksheet part of it? So it's in the instructions, Sue.
Okay.
If there's a worksheet, let's get that to you.
Okay. So, and just have the kids think. And so, depending on, you know, how much background they've got, but I love the answers they come up with. And from a teacher standpoint, this part is the really rich part of thinking it through, because the engineering and technology is a big part of the new science standards. It used to be, you know, like, we'll just learn science for the sake of science. And it wasn't tied into the real world very well. Well, the new science standards are very tightly tied in. And this is real work. So, I mean, I love what the kids come up with, but they get that the plants are very important in the watershed, so they'll just, some kids will just say, well, let's plant a lot more plants. Some kids are thinking, like, so we need these, some sort of a dam or a pond to hold the water back. And so they lots of times they'll come up with basically what we would call retention or detention ponds. You know, they would use different terms, but that's exactly what they're describing. And then the other thing I like to do is, if there's time, because we usually do this in like a 1 hour, so it's pretty fast, but if the teacher has time or we have the time, the other thing I like to do with students is just talk about, you know, so in 20 years from now, how might people manage urban runoff like this? Like, what are some of the things? And then really, I mean, it's kind of science fiction-y, but let the kids come up with something. But I've had, maybe not fourth graders, but fifth graders have definitely pretty much come up with, well, you could, because they see the detention ponds in their neighborhood, and once you start talking about them, they know that, oh yeah, that's that lot where there's, you know, we didn't know what it was for. But they'll talk about how, you know, you use computers to control the size of the opening and let more or less water out. And that's exactly what I think, you know, stormwater will be someday. We'll be able to, you know, look at rainfall maps in real time and close off some detention ponds and open them up later and desynchronize everything. And so, and these are the kids that we're talking to that will actually be figuring all that out one of these days. So that's why I love doing this lesson, having the kids think and just seeing what's going through their mind.
I want to open this up to questions and comments. I have three things, and I'm going to forget one. But first one, you can run a third model with engineering ideas. So, you know, that's up to them to tweak. So what are you doing here? And how can you represent that in the model? How can we make that as useful as possible? Two, this is the comment about the new standards in engineering versus science. It's not so much that they were in real world, but the process of inquiry science versus engineering are different, and now they are both highlighted explicitly in separate sections. They answer questions differently. So it's just good. What was the last thing I was going to say? I don't remember. So I'll remember sometime while the tape is still rolling. Questions, comments, suggestions, how would you guys use this?
Or share it with, because Tacoma has a bunch of educators that go out for you, so you would.
Oh, the third thing, share this with them. There's several really, really great videos that are coming with train readers, and there'll be a section called Video Library, so it'll be easy to find. There's an engineering video specifically that might be a good addition to what Susie was saying.
I think it'd be fun to do a flash flood mob kind of video of this. A lot of little kids or middle schoolers, I think. Get middle schoolers.
Yes.
They're perfect.
Yes.
What's the maximum number of kids that you would work with this? Not great. Total campus.
Me? Probably 45. That's brave. Don't start there.
And you're not going to have that size of a group very often. You're either going to have one class, or you might have two small classes in a group of 45.
I would have thought whenever teachers want to combine classes, and you know, if you have to, there's three, split them into two, so you've got groups of 45. Maybe you'll get smaller class sizes someday, and you'll have to deal with this. But along those lines, I don't know if you guys noticed that I ran out and swapped Tiffany's card. One thing that I do religiously with this lesson that is a little bit different than Susie is when it comes to, it's not up there anymore, the different hydrologies, and I don't have 28 students, I will hand pick the exact 28 cards that go out because I want those ratios to be as close as possible to the ratios that are on those diagrams. And if you have a group of 10 and you just pick random from your 30 cards, you're not going to get that. And so I planned for 14, we get 10. I looked and I'm like, oh my goodness, you know, I need to get a transpiration card out there right now, or there won't be a single person. So those ratios are actually here in your lesson. So it tells you the percentages, you know, we want 10% of evaporation, and you want 15% of your cards to be evaporation/surface runoff. So if you have 45, one, you need to print more cards to use this to figure out how to distribute them.
So the other funky thing is, and Car and I were both talking about, it's just kind of weird and we don't know quite how to explain it other than, you know, models are useful, some models are wrong. This is the all this model's wrong part. So you notice we're collecting the data for the peak of the flood. I mean, and this is not something you'll need for students, but just for you all to know how these really work. So we're graphing the two peaks, you know, the
forested peak and then the urban peak. And we're just having people start at zero, which is really normal flow, because it's not like zero flow in a creek. And we're just having to draw a line up to it. And then I just tell the kids what I'm doing with them. I just tell them. You know, usually when floods come up, they ramp down at about the same rate. You know, it's kind of they're symmetrical. So I just tell the kids if it took 20 seconds to come up, it took 20 seconds to go down, and connect those two lines. But I bring in hydrographs from our real rivers and from real floods, and so they can see how a real hydrograph actually looks. And
that's
they're really symmetrical.
Yeah.
To show different storms.
Yeah.
People mm-hmm. love that stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah,
especially the ones with the rainfall spikes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I do that. That's where I just, you know, because the model, we don't do the how to get back to the normal flow part. You're just going to gloss over that.
Yeah.
And again, with fourth graders and fifth graders, I don't care that we gloss over that, because that's not the point of the lesson.
Right. And you can go on on the Dream Rivers website will be some links to websites with river flow data. So you could pick a river in their watershed and then after and monitor, you know, what's the next storm? Why don't you guys take a look at what happens in your own watershed? So there'll be links to that. And you know, too, as GS links, they're not all that kid friendly, so helping the teachers with how to use it, the most kid friendly I can find. Questions, comments?
Should the two infiltration drops, should that become one drop when the watershed is developed because infiltration is reduced?
Remember how I planned for 14 and there were only 10 of you?
Yeah.
So I caught Tiffany's swap, I didn't, this wasn't for 10, so I had extra cards, and actually probably only one of you with the 10 would have ended up filtering into the ground, and so you would have stayed and Bill would have been a runoff.
Oh, okay.
So that was, once again, you know, you gotta be kind of picky because
I
noticed that.
And what I do, because you know the kids don't see the lesson plan, they don't see the more realistic percentages. When I do it, I just do 25% of each kind.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on, I talk about, if we get that deep, again, fourth and fifth graders,
yeah.
If they're off, they're not gonna remember that later when they become a stormwater engineer that Susie told her a wrong figure. So I'm perfectly okay with just having a 25, 25, 25. And I just say that, because there is no exact amount of evaporation. It's going to depend on the weather, it's going to depend on your watershed, and the infiltration is going to depend on your soil. So we even have ranges, we don't have an exact number. So I don't even bother with the percentages. I just make 25, 25, 25, 25.
That's an easy way to do it. And certainly for the forested landscape, I mean, really, you're talking about a difference of 15% there. It's really not a big deal. What do you do, Suze? What's the easy way for the urban landscape? What are your ratios for that?
I just leave it the same. And
what changes?
Oh, because in my cards, everybody becomes surface water. And how I do this is the part that
not everybody's surface water.
In my cards, so the green side is 25%, and then the yellow side, which is the urban, right? Everyone has surface water in big letters, but then they all have little teeny letters what they used to be. And so when I'm talking about with students second time, I'll say, now look at the big letters and who is evaporation. And if you're evaporation in big letters, then you can stand up and you're done with your water cycle. Well, but nobody has that because I'm great with the gig. But we talk about how would there be just a little bit of evaporation? And how would there be just a little bit of transpiration? So that's how I do it. And also from a teacher going into a school and doing four of these right in a row to do all the math, get the cards set up right, is just too much trouble.
When you have 30 and then you have 28, it's not a big deal. But when you have 10, it's a big deal to pay attention. So if you have a full-size classroom, just walk in there with 32 cards and don't worry about the 4 or 5 kids that aren't there that day. But when you have a homeschool group of 9,
I've done a slightly more, I've done, like, if you want to do this as an outdoor activity, there are ways to do that too. It's more active, where you actually, and it doesn't go as intensive as like having the cards, but you could modify it to do this way. but to describe sort of the same thing in a more active way, you can spread kids out in the middle of, like, this is the top of the watershed, that's the bottom of the watershed, you're trying to keep your raindrop, you're trying to go from one to the other, and then it's spread kids out who are trees in the middle, and you can make them either stationary or not stationary. They tag you. If they tag you, they stay stationary. You have to run around them 5 times, and then you continue to the creek with your hand raised and you've already been tagged. So it gets the same idea across,
yeah,
but it's more.
The idea that there's, it takes longer.
Right, and then you remove trees from the middle,
yeah,
area, and then they go faster.
Yeah. And again, I mean, you could, you know, when you're at some sort of fair, you know, I would have a little whiteboard and I would just write down the data. I wouldn't have, you know, if you're at a fair situation, you don't have time to sit down and graph all this. But we would just talk about, you know, people are willing to hang around, talk about how fast it went the second time. So, yeah. But this would be in a classroom.
Do a lot of kids run screaming at the end? Like, I noticed when I did that, I had this internal urge.
No, because I always, from experience, I tell them, I says, you guys all have rules about how fast you can walk in the hallways, right? So you can walk that fast, but you can't walk any faster. And I've never had kids go running.
Except for the
steps. How was that?
I have. Well, usually when we're outside, and I don't
have to let them.
Anyway, so.
Any concerns about wearing masks? I really definitely want to address those.
I think it's great.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Well, apologies for the poor video quality. We did what we can. And thank you all for being great.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, Janet, it's back up for you.
Yeah,
so good.